I see Belgium taking it.
But of course, you also have to point out, like, the individual matchups are very important. Mm. Like, we're going to see, say, Kompany squaring off with Firmino or Jesus, whoever plays. Mm. And we're going to see Ferreira Carrasco is playing at left back. And that has been a problem position for them so far. Would Brazil target that side? Because Ferreira Carrasco is simply not a defender.
You know, my issue with Brazil is the individual play comes at the expense of the team. Such that you see Neymar wants to carry the ball around, but then it comes at the expense of the team. So it could cost them. But we've seen individuals carry a team, as Cristiano has carried Portugal before.
Yeah,
so
true.
Neymar could do, as Robin, I can disagree with Robin, but Neymar could carry Brazil. It's a difficult match to call, but I'm backing Belgium.
Interesting that you bring in Cristiano into this. He has departed the World Cup.
Mm.
And they were beaten by Uruguay.
Yeah.
And Cavani scored twice. Was this a surprise for you, Shiza? Was this a surprise that they were beaten by Uruguay?
That is, okay, it did not come to a surprise, because when you're watching the match, in as much as you may see that this particular player like Ronaldo, you expect him to maybe take his team to the win, but when you look at the way the game is going, the way the Uruguayan players are doing their game, I mean, you can see that there's a high probability, they have the potential. In as much as they are not as much known as the likes of Ronaldo, they have the potential. So I think you can judge the match by how you're seeing them playing.
Yeah, of course. And of course, a very important part of the game was the two Uruguayan defenders, Diego Godin and Jose Maria Jimenez.
Mm.
What do you think about their performance, Robin, in stopping
Cristiano?
First of all,
before I go forward, I can say about Ronaldo, the guys at Real Madrid, you see the guys are from different countries, and so they feed us. So if you look at the way they play, at someone, your brilliance can't carry your team. You have to gel, so that when De Bruyne bring that pass to Lukaku, and he does the job. Going forward to the two defenders, Godin is my man.
Yeah.
He has a sense of command, and I can say, I think he's the captain too.
Yeah, he's the captain.
His maturity is needed there. And also Maria, they gel so well. And I know they will play something good.
Yeah, and of course, like, one thing people say about the Uruguayans is how passionate they are about their football.
Mm.
And before the game, Griezmann was trying to stoke this emotion by saying he's part Uruguayan. And Suarez said, no, you're French. Mm. And even in today's game, just in injury time, Jose Maria Jimenez started crying because, you know, he felt that he's leaving the World Cup. So is this a problem that, say, countries like Brazil have, that their players aren't as passionate?
I think passion is important. We've seen passion carry people to championships. It's something I've noticed among South Americans. I'm not saying that other countries are not as passionate, but South Americans are very passionate about their team. If you look at how Uruguay was pressing today, it shows you that they had the zeal to go forward. If you look at how Colombia played England, they were 1-0 down, they fought and came back and equalized, and went all the way to penalties. I mean, that passion is enviable.
All right, let's talk about Colombia, the Colombia-England game.
Mm.
John Stones, the England defender, is on record and saying that Colombia is the dirtiest team he has ever faced.
I mean, that's just a style of play. As much as the Colombians were hard, Carlos Sanchez in that midfield, a very tough guy. They were hard, yes, but that's just a style of play. And I think I saw it was quite a challenge for especially European teams to deal with that strength and that agility of South Americans and Africans.
Yeah, and that is important. And of course, like, you remember the moment when, is it Wilmer Barrios hit someone in the face?
Yeah.
Yes.
And it wasn't reviewed. And you were here a couple of weeks ago saying that VAR is a bad thing, that they should never review. Do you still think that these decisions should never be reviewed?
I mean, let me correct you first. I didn't say VAR is a bad thing, but I had an issue with it. I mean, it's destroying the you
the
see, we enjoy those bad decisions. I mean, we enjoy those controversies in football, and we've seen this. Our issue with VAR is that it's like it's not going in favor of our teams, the teams we support. For instance, it didn't go in favor of Africans. But then my only issue with VAR was it doesn't have to rescind a decision by a referee. I mean, it should only complement that decision. But when we see that a decision has been made, then the referee goes to VAR and rescinds that decision, calls back that decision. I mean, to me, it doesn't add up.
Trisha, do you feel the same thing about VR?
Yeah, I back up his point because I believe that some of the things that you are watching, as a viewer, you can tell that this was a clear foul, but then the referee goes to the VAR, comes back, maybe that penalty is denied. I think, I feel that that VAR has been really unfair. Maybe we can be unobjective at times, but I believe that some objectivity is lacking some of these referees.
Someone like Harry Kane would dispute that because he has done a lot of penalty decisions.
Let me oppose. Yeah. VAR is a very nice idea because you'll benefit from it and the other one will benefit from it. What matters is the crucial time that it comes in handy. Because like now, there's one game where I can't remember. One defender, he just went up and then the ball hit him. I don't remember that game.
It was Argentina.
Yeah, Argentina. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Marcos. Mm-hmm. That was a clear penalty. Mm-hmm. But the ref just refused to give the penalty. Mm-hmm. But when you see people, it has benefited people and the same, it has just laid down people. So what I can say, VR must stay, and the ref, the ref must also cool down. Let him not point to the spot before the VR reviews the decision.
And that's actually my point. The referee shouldn't call back a decision.
Yes, well.
He should only pause and wait for a VR decision to help him make a decision. Mm. VR should only compliment, not call back, not help the referee in calling back decision. Mm.
So, in your view, for instance, the South Korean goal against Germany, the first goal should have been ruled off because the linesman had flagged as offside, but then the VR decision changed it.
So my point is, the referee shouldn't award a goal in such an instance. He shouldn't award a goal first. He should signal that he needs assistance from the referee. For an instance like the penalty that was awarded, the penalty Mane won and the VAR rescinded that decision. The referee shouldn't have pointed to the spot. That's my opinion. Mm. The referee should have waved that I need assistance from the video assistants, then awards the penalty or not, depending on the decision. So it should only complement a decision by the referee, not to help the referee rescind those decisions.
Yeah. And also there are some open faults or even mistakes. Like now, mimi nikiwa hapa Kenya, si lazima refa ende aone hii ni handball.
It's true.
Si ndio?
Yeah.
So some things, sasa kama penalty, anafa ingine yaite. Like now, unajua linesman ako hapo amsaidie. So if the flag is up, acha tu ekele hiyo ball hapo. And let it be an offense. Kwa sababu, si poa kila siku tukimbilie VR. Mm-hmm. Some things are so open.
On that note, I'd like to add, like there was the last group stage between Senegal and Colombia. I mean, I don't know if you all can agree with me, but there was a clear penalty that Senegal was denied.
Yes.
But then with the VAR, now you agree that VAR sometimes can cause something that you're like, this was obviously a penalty. You can even listen to the commentator saying,
true,
Senegal has just been denied a penalty. So I believe that technology, in as much as many people are supporting it and others, I don't believe it's fair enough.
All right, let's talk about Senegal for some instance. They're one of the better playing African teams, but none of the five African teams qualified for the second round. And in 2026, the communication from FIFA is that Africa is going to have 9 representatives to the World Cup. So is having 9 representatives to the World Cup really beneficial if none of them make it to the second round? Trisha?
I don't think to be of any value, considering that you'll feel like if there's no African team, what value am I going to add to, even if I participate in this particular competition? I feel like if these African teams are there, it would be more valuable to have these representatives taking part in it.
Do you think Senegal was unlucky to
I get believe out? It was totally unlucky because then considering going back to the point of the points, they are tied in goal difference and the points, and then the issue of fair play comes in. I believe now that's another problem. There are so many rules here that
FIFA implemented that new rule, and there was an interesting situation.
Mm.
Was it during the Germany South Korea game, where there were two simultaneous games? And the thought was that if Sweden won by one goal and Germany won by one goal, all these teams would be tied, right?
Mm.
And you'd need fair play. And of course, like Robin, you mentioned it earlier, how in CECAFA, the CECAFA competition, to bring us back closer home, Gor Mahia in the group with Veron Sports, and they both had five points.
Same
number of goals scored, same number of goals conceded.
Mm.
But then Gor Mahia it was there, they finished top of the table because they had one less yellow card.
Yeah.
So is this fair play a good thing? Shouldn't there be like penalties to decide? Robin, what do you think?
Okay, let me say, fair play is a must. Do you know, discipline must be in football. Football is a disciplined game, and let us play with the rules that were there. When I accumulate so many red cards and then go all the way to the final, let's also appreciate the teams that played so well with a lot of discipline. And that's why you see, even at the end of the tournament, there is a present for the fair play team, the team that carried itself so well. Football is not about winning, but the respect and the fair play that you carried along.
But what is the point of being in the World Cup if it's not about winning?
No, of course, you have to win, but you have to win so legitimately. And you have to carry yourself so well. The keyword, discipline and respect. You can't bully everybody around. And let's say you get to the finals after you have injured the many opponents, umewavunja vunja, ati sasa tunaenda pia tuko na 10 red cards na ile team ilikata kuqualify kwa sababu tulitoa key player wao, tuliwavunja, si ndio?
Yes.
Hakuna rahisi kwa ball, wacha tukue na discipline. Kama umepata card 10, allow a team that haina card pia ipenye.
So
there are some solo players, eh?
Yeah.
Mtu kama kina Pepe, kina Diego Costa. Like now you remember Diego Costa? Alikuja akafunga bao after alikuwa amepiga elbow nani Pepe.
Yeah.
Do you remember?
Yeah, I remember.
Sasa jamaa kama huyo ref angeona atikenye Diego Costa anafanya, kwanza angeacha hiyo ball ikae. Ambie Pepe amke na apatie jamaa kadi Diego Costa. Fair play lazima ikuwe, tusiumizane kwa ball. Now when you abolish that knee, fair play stuff, mpira itaharibika tu sana.
I was thinking of fair play, like teams who play up. Let us actually talk about the Colombia-England game.
Mm.
So, Colombia without James Rodriguez, and they put three defensive midfielders in midfield, and they went hammer and tongs for it.
Mm.
And they almost won, had one of the players' penalties was saved. Had that not been saved by Pickford, they would have gone through. So, wouldn't that have worked for them? What do you think, Teresa? Wouldn't that have worked, them playing dirty against England?
I don't think that's justifiable, because at the end of the day, as he's saying, fair play, I mean, how you play is very important. You cannot go, you know, committing all these fouls and expect that at the end of the day we are going to win regardless of how many fouls you are going to commit. So true. I don't think it's justifiable to say, in as much as you are going to win, it's just okay to just go committing every other foul.
By Italy, you remember, won the World Cup in 2006 based on like this sort of games with Gattuso in midfield and Alessandro Nesta and Cannavaro and Materazzi in midfield. In fact, remember the final, Materazzi, what he did against Zidane.
But
him doing this enabled them to be 10 men, one France to be 10 men. Wasn't that helpful?
Well, at the end of the day, there will be two sides to that story. Of course, they'll celebrate because they've won, but at the end of the day, the opponent will also feel that this was not fair enough, you know? There were all these fouls committed, but again, you're just going to say, okay, they've won, but at the expense of the other team.
Mm. Oh, yeah, that's fair. Right? Speaking about fair play teams, Japan, of course, like qualified at the expense of Colombia, and they developed the habit of, after every game, cleaning their dressing room, and their fans would
volunteering,
would clean the stands. But of course, they lost to Belgium. What do you think? What do you make of that game?
I mean, they lost to Belgium. They gave a fight. All credit to Japan. They were 2-0 up. They couldn't hold on. They gave a fight. But then their act of fair play. I'm longing to see such acts in Kenya. I'm longing to see guys queuing to enter stadiums in
You're longing to see Gor Mahia fans clean up the stadium.
I'm longing to see Gor Mahia and FC Leopards fans coming together, cleaning up the stadium. You see, fair play, as Robin is insisting. Yeah, fair play is good.
It's good. But let's go back to the Japan-Belgium game, for instance. I'll come back to you, Robin. When Belgium were 2 goals down, they brought on Fellaini and started crossing, like just crossing balls into the air, and it worked.
Mm.
And it seems to me that a lot of teams are playing this physical aerial game. Of course, like France have Giroud, and Germany, when things were bad, they brought on Mario Gomez, and of course Russia have Zuba. So is this like, why is this happening right now, that teams are bringing their big men to battle for crosses?
First of all, I'd like to credit Belgium's composure. You could see even when there were two goals down, they were very composed. They were very composed. And if you look at the Belgium team, they are very good physically. Look at Alderweireld, Kompany, Vertonghen, Fellaini. They're very tall players. Lukaku is still there. So these are the strengths I think Martinez saw they could capitalize on, considering Japan aren't. Yoshida is the only physically built player in the Japan squad. So every coach has tactics that he can run to to win a match.
So do you think like this could have helped Spain, that they did not carry Morata, who is really good in the air? Like, had they carried Morata, would they have brought him in and maybe taken the game against Russia?
Robin? Okay. The issue of physicality in a game, it adds up so much to the results that you have. Someone like Fellaini is a muscular guy. And when you bring a cross, the guy will not fast, he'll go up the whole body and then head the ball. He's too tall. Eh? What I can say, physicality matters in a game of football. And we have to appreciate the fact that the guy spent so much time in the gym. Okay, the issue of I heard John Stones saying that it was the dirtiest game that he has ever faced with Colombia. Let me tell you, there are some players who don't have the strength, the muscles to play football. But what they'll do, inaitwa footworks. Atakufanya hivi hata kama una muscles kubwa kama ndovu. Utapiga chenga huko uende. You see? So Colombia sasa wakaona hao watu hatuwezi washinda mambo za nini? Chenga wanatupiga. So acha tuende hard. Wao wakienda hard wangeleta pia watu wakubwa. Ndio sasa game itoshane. Lakini ball kwa mbaya pale watu wanaanza kuumizana, si poa sana. But if you have muscular guys in your team, bring them and let's win that way.
Okay, let's talk about like the smallest player, everyone's favorite small player, Messi, is out of the World Cup. What do you think about the Argentina team? Like, what happened to them? Real quick, because we're almost out of time.
Okay, I would like to say, I think there's something about the public, maybe the perception you have about a player, that when you talk about Argentina, you cannot talk about Argentina and not talk about Messi. But they forget about that, the fact that you cannot talk about a player and you're talking about a team, because in as much as this player is good, how he cooperates with the other players is very important. So I think there was something amiss between how Messi was coordinating with teammates that led to their final failure.
Right. And what about Spain? Teresa again? They bring it back to you. What happened to Spain? Why are they out?
I didn't want to talk about Spain because it was so heartbreaking, because you look at how they're playing, you're like, they have the potential. In as much as the game went to overtime and the penalties, we feel that were it not for penalties, these people had a chance to win. So I feel like it's just unfortunate when a game goes to penalties.
All right. Let's take a step back from the World Cup. I talk about CECAFA for me. Robin, what is happening in CECAFA apart from, of course, the flair play Maninas with goal? What else is happening in CECAFA?
Allow me to speak in Swahili. Sasa hapa ndo tuko. Gor Mahia. Tulienda huko na Kenya tumepewa timu moja. Tunacheza timu moja. Tanzania imepewa Sigida na ile jeshi ya kujenga taifa from Zanzibar.
Of course, they also have
na pia Simba.
Yeah.
Uganda Azam.
Yeah,
Azam na Uganda iko na Vipers na kuna Rayon Sports ya Rwanda. Let me tell you, hiyo pool yetu hata sikuwa na shida sisi kupenya tu through. Sisi kama Gor. Lakini ule ona Rayon tulicheza nayo Continental.
Yeah.
Tukainyorosha. Sasa tukienda pale sikuwa najua nini ili happen. There are so many rumors that hatukuwa tumelipwa, ma players wetu walikuwa on a ghost low, na pia ile ku digest that Kagere alienda. But let me tell you, mpira kukuchi the same way. The same way a day is different from the other one. Mpira tu hivyo na anaweza sema Gor venye tu inafanya, ina try. Umeona Filemon pia walifunga jana Momani. It's a nice gesture. So mimi nitasema tumejichuna tukajitune na quarter finals hatutachukulia ovyo ovyo.
Oh, of course, quarter finals Gor inacheza na Serunkuma is going to
sasa be there. Serunkuma unajua alikuwa wetu na akatufungia bao mingi kabla aende Bandari. Sasa amerudi kwa Vipers pale na amemaliza ligi na amechukua Golden Boot na amesema aogopi kitu. Kenya alifunzwa hapa, anajua Kenya wanafanya huko. So mimi nitamwambia hivi, mi nitasema Gor tukue serious pia, coach wetu pia walan venye wamesikia. Na you know rumors are so bad eh? Ukisikia kama sasa Kahata,
yeah, Kahata,
Kahata kuna mambo mingi sana. Ni the same Kahata kicheza ball asijibebe kama Messi. Do you know Messi pia na Mohamed Salah ni wale watu walipewa load kwa mgongo yao.
Mm.
Wewe tubebe hii timu yako inaangaliwa na Wakenya wao. Mm. So Kahata hata kama ni ako alleged ati anaongea na watu wa Simba, anaweza pia aenda. Lakini coach leo nimemsikiza na amesema Kahata is worth 1.3 billion.
Yeah,
but za Kenya.
So, yeah, yeah.
So mimi nitasema Kahata tu atulie. Na kama player mimi siwezi fungia player yote yaende, development ya player ni muhimu sana. Kwa hivyo kama anajifeel, acha tu aende tu na njia the legitimate way. Aende tu apige shughuli yake, ajidevelop na aone kama anaweza piga pasta zingine. Tuta replace Kagere, at least umeleta Mustafa.
Let me cut you off just there, like another player who is also moving at this time.
Yeah.
There is a rumor that Cristiano enda Juve. We're going to get about Cristiano earlier, like is this a good decision for all involved that Anacha Real under Juve?
You see, it caught me by surprise. It was the last thing I expected for Ronaldo to go to Juventus. I expected him to come to Man U or go to USA. But it was the last thing that I expected Ronaldo to go to Juventus. But in my opinion, it's a good move for him just to get out of. He needs to go to a less pressure league. Mm-hmm. So that we can see more of him. I mean, people are, we're already used to him. We're already used to him scoring 3 goals, 5 goals in La Liga. He needs a new experience, and I'd love him. I'd love to see him in Juventus.
All right, and that's fair. Teresa, like really quick thoughts on the Ronaldo transfer?
Well, as he's saying, I believe it's a good experience. Sorry, it's a good experience for him to move to a different team and see his potential, if he's going to perform even better, or maybe he's going to have the mentality that this is a smaller team. But okay, we hope that he'll be much better.
Oh yeah, and just to wind things up, of course, France are in the World Cup semis. I'm just going to ask everybody, Ian, which team is in the World Cup?
I was backing Germany, and I was very sure that they would win the World Cup.
Yeah.
I was very disappointed that they went out of the World Cup bottom of their group.
Yeah.
But right now I'm just watching football, but I hope Belgium do something.
Of course, like knowing your history, you saying that means that they're going to be beaten.
I stick with Belgium,
yeah.
Belgium, France.
You aren't afraid of Ian's mambo jumbo. He supported Germany.
Belgium, okay. I'm not supporting them wholeheartedly. I'm also looking at France and other good sides. But Belgium, if you look at the quality in Belgium's team, I mean, they are good.
Robin, are we still Team France?
Hiyo hata itaki kusemekana kwa sababu before the World Cup started, I started counting about 2,000 days to the World Cup. Na nilikuwa nimesema mimi ni France.
Wait, 2000 days being 8 years ago.
Wow. Hata venye nilisikia itakuwa Russia, nisema actually sijai support nchi nyingine. Hata France sasa itolewe, nitasema hakuna World Cup ilikuwa Russia.
Let me ask a question. Are you an Arsenal fan?
Team kubwa hiyo Arsenal.
There's no single player from Arsenal in that France squad. So I don't know his motivation.
Club yangu tu eh. Kwanza sasa hivi nakwambia tufanye hivi. Mi sitasema ati next season, lakini ni kumoto.
Oh, yeah, that's fair. We'll be right here at the beginning of the season. I feel we ran out of time. But of course, there's a thing people are saying on social media how Giroud is in Chelsea for the money, but he's an Arsenal player at heart. So he has an Arsenal player. Thank you for joining with us today. As usual, I was Kerry Baraka with you on Spotify today. We had our guests, Ian, Teresa, and Robin, and we talked football. And there's a lot of sports action over the weekend. The World Cup is going on. Belgium is playing with Brazil at 9. And there's going to be Gold Cup action tomorrow between Kenya 15s and Uganda. Watch out for that game. Of course, Wimbledon is also happening at the moment. So a lot of sports action to keep you entertained until we meet again next week. Goodbye. We'll be right back.
Y254. Imagine. Y254. Imagine.